So, by way of introduction, my name is Scott Powers, and it's my pleasure to introduce you to the session this morning. And we have at least two outstanding speakers, speakers number two and three. It's my job today to actually sort of set the stage for these two outstanding speakers. And my role is really analogous to if you go to a concert and the leading act, you know, of course, doesn't come out front first. They send out a band that's not too talented, and so they warm up the audience a little bit, and then the real rock stars come on. And so that's my role today, to be a warm-up band to get you excited about our speakers that follow. So my talk today will be the first one. I'll talk about exercise-induced oxidative stress, a little bit about the history, a good bit about the history, actually, and I'll introduce some of the topics that will be discussed by the following speakers, that is the cause and consequences of exercise-induced oxidative stress. Our second speaker is Dr. Malcolm Jackson, who needs no introduction to those of you that study redox biology, and he's going to talk about some new insights into redox regulation of muscle adaptation to contractile activity. And our third and final speaker is also well known to the redox community, Dr. Gomez Cabrera from the University of Valencia, and she's going to talk about an update on antioxidants and muscle adaptation to exercise training. So with that as a big picture introduction of where we're going to go over the next 90 minutes, let's get started. So for those of you that are new to the field, I show this slide just to sort of show you a little bit about the evolution of the interest in this area. And if you were to do a PubMed search using the search terms exercise and oxidative stress, and you searched in 1978, you would find one paper. You did the same search in 1990, a whopping eight papers, exponential increase already, right? 2000, you'd find 87. But if you did the same search this past year, you'd find 539 papers just showing what changes have taken place in the field. So here's a roadmap of where I'm going to take you over the next 18 to 20 minutes. Most of my talk is going to be a historical overview to sort of set the context for the younger people in the audience that have not grown up in this field of free radical biology and redox biology. So I'll spend a significant amount of time just talking about that, and hopefully we'll have some fun. You can see the origins of where this work all came from. And the second part of the talk, I'm going to really just introduce exercise-induced oxidative stress as to what are the causes, where do the oxidants come from, and this will be addressed in a great deal more detail by our next speakers. And then finally, I'll introduce some of the topics that are going to be addressed by the speakers, talking about the consequences of exercise-induced oxidative stress. So with that big picture introduction, let's talk about the history of free radical biology and free radicals in general. And if you think about it, there are actually two eras of research in free radicals, and that is the chemical era and then followed by the biological era, which is just a little over 60 years old, actually. So let's talk a little bit about the chemical era. And so it all starts, in my opinion, with the discovery of oxygen. And if you read the history of science, you might be surprised to find out that there's a debate about who actually discovered oxygen. Now, if you're in the audience and you're from England, you're pretty sure that Priestley discovered oxygen in 1774, actually was the first paper. But if you're from Scandinavia, you're also pretty sure that William Scheele might have discovered it, because his personal papers suggested that he discovered what appeared to be oxygen in 1772. If you're from France, you're quite sure it was none of these two people, but it was actually Lavoisier, and that he did extensive experiments on isolating oxygen. But regardless of your nationality and who you believe actually discovered oxygen, I think we can all agree that all three of these people contributed significantly to isolating oxygen and studying the unusual properties of fire air, if you will. Well, we progress. We don't know about radicals yet, but Henry Fenton is a student in a laboratory in Cambridge. He and a colleague were simply horsing around, if you will, and mixing chemicals. And when they put together a combination of hydrogen peroxide, ferrous iron, and tartaric acid, this beautiful violet color appeared. And so this fascinated Fenton. He studied this the rest of his life. He didn't fully understand throughout his life what had actually happened, but as it turns out, this was one of the first chemical reactions illustrating oxidation. And it was important, but important later after the original discovery. Well, you can't study free radicals without understanding, of course, that electrons are involved. And electrons were discovered by J.J. Thomson, who was a Cambridge physicist. Evidently, he was extremely brilliant, but not good with his hands. So he was noted to break a lot of glassware when he was actually in the laboratory. So I think most of the work in his lab was done by people with more dexterity. But for after the discovery of electrons, he won the Nobel Prize in 1906. The first recorded record of a published moderately stable radical was published in 1900 by Moses Gomberg. He was born in Russia. He went to school at the University of Michigan and was actually at the University of Michigan when he published this paper. And some people credit him with being the father of free radical chemistry, although that's debatable. It depends on your nationality, I think, as to who you credit with that. Well, ending the period of the so-called chemical entity of study actually was a period during World War II, and World War II actually contributed markedly to the study of free radicals, because radicals in these days were used to synthesize materials for war, to polyethylene in particular, and they were involved in a wide variety of chemical synthesis. And unfortunately, another part of World War II that actually provided a great interest in free radical biology was the damage that occurred from ionizing radiation following the nuclear blast that took place in Japan. And so radiation poisoning became actually a great motivation for scientists to understand what it's about ionizing radiation that actually causes mutations and damage and death. So, let's leave the chemical entity and talk about the area that you're the most interested in, and that's the biological era of free radical biology. So it actually begins in 1954, and there are two papers that launched this era. One of the first was published in Nature by Barry Commoner, and this was the first paper to describe the fact that living cells actually produce radicals. Another really important paper published the same year in Science by Gerstler and Dan Gilbert actually postulated and had some experiments to support the postulate that the impact of ionizing radiation on cells was actually because radicals were produced. And they also postulated that while it had long been known that there was oxygen toxicity, that when patients breathed 100% oxygen, in the hospital, they may have improved their condition over the first 24 to 48 hours, but they developed a lung injury and pulmonary edema and oftentimes died. And so Gerstler and Daniels, basically postulated that radicals were responsible for ionizing radiation damage and for hyperoxia-mediated damage of the lungs. And this was really an important finding. Britton Chance, 2 years later, published some important papers where he studied the role of catalase in removing hydrogen peroxide, and he first described the fact that respiring mitochondria actually produce and release hydrogen peroxide. The free radical theory of aging was proposed by Denham Harmon in 1956, and while there wasn't much data to support this at the time, it really motivated scientists to want to understand the possibility that aging actually is a progress of damaged macromolecules in cells, and that oxidants and radical production was the genesis of this, and this work continues until today. And the final paper I want to mention in this particular era was a paper, I think, that was extremely important to stimulate research in the field and really give credence to the fact that radicals in cells are probably an important part of normal biology. And this was the discovery of superoxide dismutase 1. And this was actually a rediscovery of already a known protein that was first described as this first antioxidant enzyme in 1969. And basically what it pointed out to biologists was that cells obviously are designed to deal with radicals, and that radicals are produced in cells continuously, and this must play a really important role in biology. And this triggered a lot of discussion and thought going forward. So the first paper describing exercise and oxidative stress was done in humans, published in 1978, by a group at the University of California at Davis, Al Tappel's group. Very simple experiment. They exercised humans on the treadmill for 60 minutes. They ran at about 50% of VO2 max, and they measured expired gases and measured pentane as a biomarker of lipid peroxidation. And what they simply showed was that compared to rest, the amount of expired pentane went up. If you supplemented these individuals with vitamin E, did the same experiment, the level of expired pentane went down. And they concluded that exercise results in oxidative stress. So moving along on the timeline, an important year was 1982, even though there wasn't a lot of work published in that particular era. But Kelvin Davies, as a graduate student at the University of California at Berkeley, published the first paper describing the fact that contracting skeletal muscles produce radicals. Dr. Jackson, our next speaker, also did some important work in this era where he described the importance of vitamin E. And if you depleted vitamin E from cells, oxidative damage increased. Lester Packer's group at that time was the first to describe that exercise training increases antioxidants, supporting the concept that exercise is indeed an antioxidant. And then finally, the first definition of oxidative stress was put forth actually in a book chapter in 1985 by Helmut Sees. And the basic definition has remained intact for several decades, even though there have been small modifications to it. So moving along in the timeline, 1990 was an important year because the first report that radicals contribute to fatigue appeared. A colleague of mine at the University of Florida, Mike Reed, published a paper in 92 describing that it appears that contracting muscles release superoxide into the extracellular space. And this stimulated a lot of discussion about, can radicals actually cross cell membranes, or are they produced actually in the membrane and released into the extracellular space? Lili G and his colleagues at the University of Wisconsin at the time started to do dose response experiments, understanding the relationship between various intensities and duration of exercise training and the induction of antioxidant enzymes in skeletal muscle. And I want to point out two other things. In the end of the 90s, the decade, it was an important paradigm shift in the thinking about radicals and cells. Up until this point, almost all of the interest in free radical biology had been on the fact that radicals are damaging, that macromolecules are oxidized, and this is likely not a good thing. But the Nobel Prize was awarded for the discovery of nitric oxide in the late 80s, and this actually started people to thinking, given that nitric oxide, of course, is a nitrogenous radical and a very important signaling molecule, people started to wonder, are oxygen radicals or oxidants, are they also signaling molecules? And of course, this turned out to be true. And again, the paradigm shift was that radicals aren't just damaging molecules, but they're important for normal cell biology. As we move along into the current time periods, again, Mike Reed made an important observation from a variety of data, his own and others, and it described a relationship between radical production and EC coupling and force production in skeletal muscle, showing that a small amount of oxidants are absolutely required for optimal force production in skeletal muscle. But once you reach that optimal level and you increase the amount of oxidation, presumably due to post-translational modifications of contractile proteins, there's actually a decline in force production, which may contribute in part to the fatigue. Our third speaker in the session today made some important contributions to understanding that ROS is indeed required, reactive oxygen species is indeed required for adaptation to skeletal muscle, and she's going to talk about some of that work. And so finally, if you move into the current decade, I think Dean Jones and his group at Emory University have really made significant contributions, at least to the discussion, the fact that There is a redox code, if you will, in cells and understanding how reactive oxygen species communicates with rather signaling molecules with phosphorylation and acetylation of cells and regulating enzymatic activity and translation and transcription is really very, very important. And our two final speakers again in this session have made major contributions to the understanding of where in the cell, the muscle cell in particular, that reactive oxygen species are produced. And that'll be discussed again in the next two sessions. So with that brief overview of the history of this work in redox biology, let's talk a little bit about some of the questions that'll be addressed coming forward about exercise-induced oxidative stress. What are the causes? So what are the sources of reactive oxygen species during exercise? Well, these are what I call all the usual suspects, and these have been studied over the last two decades. That there are certainly in animal studies, preclinical studies, it's well known that blood cells can produce radicals, epithelial cells, lung, liver, and of course, skeletal muscle. In humans, we really don't know outside of skeletal muscle where the sources of radical production because of the need to do invasive experiments. But we know a great deal from animal experiments knowing that we produce radicals in all of these cells during exercise. The first evidence that radicals were produced in contracting skeletal muscles was published by these three individuals, Kelvin Davies, Lester Packer, George Brooks at the University of California at Berkeley. And over the last several decades, there's been a great deal of discussion of trying to understand where in the cell radicals are produced, that is the contracting muscle fiber. This is an old cartoon from a review that Malcolm and I published almost a decade ago. And it describes some of the possible sites of radical production. And this will be discussed in more detail, but as you know, that there's been debate that NADPH oxidases may play a role, that xanthine oxidase may play a role, that PLA2-dependent lipases may also play a role. And of course, it's been discussed for two decades that respiring mitochondria produce radicals, and it was postulated as early as 82 that this is a major site of radical production, and I think you're going to hear today that this may not be the case. So let's talk about the last issue that I want to introduce that'll be addressed in a great deal of detail by the next two speakers, and that is, what are the consequences of exercise-produced reactive species? Well, there are many, many consequences, but there are three that have received a lot of experimental attention over the years, and that is macromolecular damage, muscle fatigue, and more recently in the last two decades, muscle signaling and adaptation. And the reality is the role that reactive oxygen species plays in the muscle cell depends upon the amount of reactive oxygen species that are produced. And this again is an old cartoon and illustrates the fact that at low levels of activity, that is activities of daily living, below 20% of VO2 max, then there's radicals produced, but it's at a level, basal oxidation level, that probably doesn't do much signaling, and there's certainly not much evidence of any macromolecular damage. But if you increase the exercise intensity to 50% of VO2 max, depending on the duration or the conditions that you're actually doing the exercise, then you do indeed, of course, get signaling effects. And if you exercise at an even higher intensity in the heat or prolonged exercise, you likely achieve both signaling effects and some macromolecular damage that may or may not have physiological consequences. And this will be discussed in a great deal of detail by the upcoming speakers. So let me just leave you with a bit of what I think are the most important eras, periods of study in the history of free radical biology, and it all began in 54. And this was due to the first discovery that living cells actually produce radicals, and the fact that hyperoxy and ionizing radiation produce radicals. And this stimulated much, much interest in the role of radicals in health. And the free radical theory of aging has not been totally supported over the years, but there is some evidence, of course, that radicals can contribute to senescence of cells. But this postulate without a lot of evidence in this era was really very revolutionary, because when you think about it, we didn't even fully know the structure of proteins at this time, and we certainly didn't know a great deal about the structure of a cell membrane. That didn't come along until the early 70s. So this was really a very, very thoughtful and provoking hypothesis to be produced this early. And again, I would credit 1969 and the discovery of SOD1 of being really a landmark year to boost the interest in free radical biology. And of course, the first evidence that exercise produces oxidants is the reason that we're all here today. So with that, I'd like to acknowledge the funders that have supported my work over the years, and hardworking folks in my laboratory that have contributed to the work that we've done over the last 2+ decades. And I'd be remiss if I didn't thank all of you for your attention. So thank you very much.